Welcome everyone to the first video of our Race Like a Pro series, and we're going to start today by talking about the friction circle. So the friction circle might be used interchangeably with words like the traction circle, the circle of forces, whatever word you've heard of, they're all okay, but we're going to go with the friction circle for now. And the friction circle ultimately is about showing how much grip you have available in the car. And because of that, we really got to start with the friction circle ahead of racing lines, ahead of braking techniques, because without understanding what grip really means and how to define that, we can't move on to more advanced topics, right? So let's have a look at what the friction circle looks like in theory. So ultimately, as you've guessed it, it's a circle, and it's supposed to show how much grip there's available. And this is what the circle, in this case, the circular diagram, is to show. So in this circle, you have the amount of grip available per tire, and ultimately it shows how much force is going through a tire depending on what you do with the car. So in a steady state, obviously there is no force going through the tire at all, except for the weight of the car. If you are, for example, as in this case, cornering, then there will be that G-force trying to load the tire, as you can feel. I try to picture that when you're going around in your own car and you do a right turn, for example, how your body weight is pushed over to the left. So that's what the red arrows in this case represent. And ultimately, what the friction circle aims to show is that red arrow still within the bounds of the circle, or does it go beyond? If, as in this case, we're within the bounds of the circle, no problem. We're within the grip limits of the tires. We're not going to slide or spin the car. If the red arrows go beyond, then that's when we face issues such as spinning the car, locking the wheels, or going into a drift. So now that you guys understand what the friction circle is about in theory, let's look at a whole car and what the friction circle really means when looking at a car. So we have a Ferrari F430 here as our model car, and one friction circle per tire. So what the friction circles show us, as I said, is the available grip in this car for each tire. What you can see is the size of the circles is actually bigger at the rear than at the front. Why is that? Well, that's because of the weight distribution of the car. So weight distribution is about how much of the weight pushes onto the front wheels and how much of the weight pushes onto the rear wheels. If it's a 50-50 distribution, obviously that's perfectly even. That is not the case in this car because it has a mid-engine, which means more of the weight is in the back of the car, meaning more weight is pushing down the car in the rear wheels, and ultimately that gives us more grip. You can see that, for example, a Porsche 911 is extremely good out of slow corners because it has so much traction, because it actually has a rear engine, which means there is additional weight pushing down the car on the rear axle, which just gives it that extra bit of grip out of slow turns. All right, so far we've only talked about cars in a steady state. When the friction circle really becomes useful is obviously once we start moving the car, once we start accelerating, braking, and turning. So let's look at the first scenario, just smoothly accelerating in a straight line. What happens and how does it impact the friction circles? Let's have a look. On the left side, we got the steady state from before just as a reference point, and on the right, we're accelerating. What happens? You can see the red arrows pointing downward just a bit. So you're still within the friction circle. Why downward? You're accelerating, but the car really wants to stand still, right? So you're pushing the car out of its comfort zone, as to say, and what happens is the car leans backward, right? We're accelerating smoothly in this case, so absolutely no problem. The red arrows are still within the bounds of the friction circle, so we're not going to lose grip in that case. You might wonder, why did the friction circles change size? Same kind of logic. So think about it in your own car when you're driving around or in sim racing. When you're accelerating, what happens is the car leans backwards, right? So weight distribution changes from its steady state to a more backward distribution. This is why the friction circles at the rear actually get bigger, because you have that extra bit of weight, again, pushing the car down, giving it some more load on those tires, which gives you more grip. The same obviously goes for braking. So what happens when you're braking? Just the other way around, the car leans forward. So what happens? The friction circles at the front increase in size. Again, at the rear, obviously, they have to give up a bit of grip as a result of that. And again, smooth braking in this case, as an example, is not going to be an issue. The red arrows do not touch the edges of the friction circles, so we're not going to lock the wheels. The ABS will not have to regulate this, and we're going to be in a comfortable situation here. So let's have a look at what that looks like in practice, and we're going to be using the game Project Cars here to show that, because they have a neat little feature where they actually show the friction circles in action as we do something. So let's check that out. So in Project Cars, you can see the four tire diagrams here, and the friction circles will only pop up once we actually start moving the car, so let's see what's going to happen.
So you can see as we smoothly start to accelerate, you can see those yellow circles at the back. As we said, the weight transfers back to the rear, but we're not pushing the limits really, so we're not spinning the wheels here. And just starting to gently slow down the car, weight shifts to the front, and we come to a stop without locking up the wheels.
So now that we had a look at the friction circles in action on track, let's think about what happens if we're pushing the car a bit too much. So what happens, for example, if we just absolutely floored from a standstill with a car that doesn't have any traction control? What's going to happen? Friction circle diagram, same thing again. We have that extra bit of grip on the rear because the car leans back, but the red arrows this time go beyond the circle. So we're given too much force through the tires, and the friction between the tires and the road just doesn't stick anymore. What happens? Traction is lost in this case. We could obviously spin that around and look at braking. What happens? Same thing. Before, we had a smooth braking maneuver. Now we're going to push the brake pedal even harder. What happens? Again, car moves to the front initially, but the pressure is just too much, so the red arrows actually go beyond the edge of the circle, meaning we're going to lock the wheels. Or if you have ABS in your car, which luckily most cars do today, you're going to have the ABS starting to work. So let's look at that in practice, again in project cars, and see what difference that makes to how the car behaves.
So same scenario here, except we're absolutely going to floor it here. You can see it on the green bar and see what's happening to the rear wheels. Yes, they're getting that grip, but they're instantly starting to spin as we're losing grip. Same goes for braking. We're maximizing brake pressure here. We lock up the wheels and go into a spin as a result.
All right, so we looked at longitudinal car maneuvers only. So acceleration and braking. The last missing piece, obviously, and that's really it about the friction circle, is turning. So what happens if we do a left or a right-hand turn? So look at that. So again, on the left side, steady state scenario. On the right, we have the example of the right turn. What happens when you turn in right in your own car? Think about it. The car leans over to the left. And same as we talked about before, wherever the car leans, we have more grip available. So what happens? The car leans over to the left, meaning the grip available on the left-hand side of the car actually increases, right? Again, that weight doesn't just come out of nowhere, so the grip on the right-hand side decreases, but that's okay because the load is on that side anyways. So let's look at the red arrows here. Again, a right turn example where we're smoothly rolling through the corner. We're not pushing it too much. The red arrows are there. Of course, there is load going through the tires, but we're not coming towards the edges of the circles, right? So we're going to have a smooth scenario. We're not going to start sliding here.
Once again, let's look at that, what it looks like in real life, or in a sim in this case. So we're constantly holding the speed, smoothly rolling around the corners, and you can just about see the friction circles showing up in this case. We're just building up a little bit of load, this time the right hand turn. You can see the circle lighting up, but we're not losing grip because we're smoothly and slowly going around that corner.
Alright, so we ticked off all boxes. We talked about braking, about accelerating, and about cornering. When the friction circle becomes extremely useful though, and what makes it such a useful tool to improve your own driving and make it the foundation of the whole Race Like a Pro series, is when we combine these factors. So say you're coming out of a slow corner, you're still turning the wheel, but you want to come on the accelerator slowly. What happens? And this is exactly when the friction circle is trying to teach you something super useful. Let's look at that. We got the friction circle here a bit zoomed in. We have the cornering force. So again, we're in a right turn. Right? Arrow goes over to the left, the car is leaning on the left-hand side, but we also accelerate that little bit, right? We're not pushing it too much. And look how the friction circle works. You basically connect these two ends of the arrows and come to a connecting point. And if that connecting point is still within the bounds of the circle, you're gonna have grip.
So we're going into the final chicane here at Silverstone, and just watch the green throttle bar at the top as we're turning. Turning the wheel now, keeping it constant, and we're still keeping the throttle at 60% throughout this turn. Look, just to get that grip going. And only once we straighten up the wheel do I actually floor it.
Same as before, we talked about the smooth scenario. Now we want to talk about the aggressive scenario. So same thing again, right hand turn. You come on the throttle slightly, but you're just overdoing it a bit too much. So what do we have here? We have a longer arrow for cornering, which is means there is more lateral force going through the car. We're turning the wheel more and we're accelerating more at the same time. And I look at each arrow individually. If we were to corner without any acceleration or braking, this arrow would be totally fine, right? It's still within the friction circle as we have it here. Same goes for the acceleration on its own. That arrow is still within the bounds of the circle, but the combination of the two is what makes it so dangerous in this case. Look, if we follow the procedure from before, so connecting the two and the connecting dot is actually outside of the circle, which means we're going to lose traction here. So let's look at what that looks like in practice and why that happens and how we can avoid it.
Same corner again, last chicane at Silverstone, and look at the difference now. As I get on the throttle too aggressively, what happens? Car loses its grip on the rear axle and just gets into a spin immediately.
So that's what happens when you accelerate too much out of a corner as you're still turning the wheel. The same obviously also applies to braking and cornering just the other way around. So let's have a look at this one just quickly because it's pretty obvious after the previous one. You're braking just a little bit, you're cornering a little bit, the connecting point is still within the circle, absolutely no problem. Obviously, if you move on to the more aggressive scenario, you're braking pretty hard, but if you were to brake on its own, absolutely no problem, right? So, because you're not touching the edge of the circle, again, same kind of cornering force would be okay on its own, but the combination of these two inputs, quite a lot of brake pressure and a lot of turning input, actually move that point outside of the circle, which means you're going to lock the wheels or have the ABS kick in, or you're going to understeer through that corner. Don't want to talk about too much about understeering in this video. That's going to be part of a whole later series. But this is what's going to happen here, and that's obviously not ideal because you're going to lose control of the car, same as in the aggressive acceleration case.
Starting with the smooth scenario, look how I come off the brake as soon as I turn in. Coming off the brake means I can turn in more, we have more grip available, and therefore make that corner nicely and can gently accelerate right out of it. Same corner again, but look at the difference now. Look at the difference in brake pressure and turn in angle. That's just too much brake. And look what happens, the car understeer slides over the front wheels and we have to do a long arc to get back on track.
And that's all you really need to know about friction circles for now. We talked about accelerating, about braking, about cornering, and about combining these factors into each other. But before we move on to the next video, I want to talk a bit about what impacts the size of friction circles and therefore the grip available to you. So the number one biggest factor, tires. Think about it, tires have different compounds, from very grippy to not very grippy at all. Naturally, the grippier your tire is, the bigger your friction circle is gonna be. Second tire factor, tire size, or tire width specifically. Look at race cars, they have absolutely massive tires. Why is that? Well, simply speaking, the more rubber that is touching the road, the more force you can put through that tire, right? So the bigger the tire, the bigger your friction circle. And third, and a really important factor that people forget, tire age. You can have an amazing race tire, which was super expensive. If you've raced it for 200 laps, it's not going to be at peak performance. Pretty obvious, right? So your friction circle is going to shrink in size. Second factor we have, weight. Weight of the car we talked a bit about in terms of weight distribution, and there's no need to go into too much physical detail, but weight has a huge impact, right? We talked about the Porsche 911 example, that extra weight giving it more traction at the rear, but don't mistake that for a reason to just dump weight in your car. Because obviously, yes, in a steady state, more weight will give you more grip initially, more traction. But obviously, you're going to have to carry that weight around. So it makes your acceleration faster, you're going to have to brake earlier, and you can't corner as fast because that weight is actually pushing the forces through those tires. So speaking about our diagrams, the red arrows will just get longer much faster, so it actually makes your car slower. Third factor, aerodynamics. Again, no need to go into detail, driving with wings and aerodynamics will be a whole other section of this Race Like a Pro series, but just simply speaking, the more downforce, so more force pushing the car down because of aerodynamic aspects you have, the bigger your friction circles, which is why Formula One cars, for example, can corner so fast. Fourth factor, the weather. You can have the best driver in the world with the newest tires and a perfectly set up car. If it's raining, the grip is just going to be less than in the dry. Simple as that, and that's pretty obvious, I think. When it's snowing, less and less, and if it's ice, there's barely any circle size left. So let's have a look at what that looks like just representatively here. So we got the different comparisons. So on the left side, we got our dry scenario that we talked about before, and just look how much smaller it gets if it's raining. And again, as I said, if there is ice or snow, there's barely any grip left, right? So even if you have a $200,000 car, you're not going to have that much grip available if it's on ice. Keep that in mind. Fifth factor, surface. Again, surface is really important because, right, what gives you grip is not just the tire and the car on its own, but also the coefficient of friction between the tire and the road. And the surface obviously has a massive impact on that. And we're also talking about surface changes at a later stage in the series, because tracks like the Nürburgring actually don't have a consistent surface, but constantly get new surfaces here and there. So you got to watch out for that. Think about it when you go around a track, and you might wonder, why is it that I always bend my car in that corner? Might be because of a surface change just before. And last but not least, we get elevation as a factor that impacts friction circle sizes. Elevation, again, part of a later series video, but going up and downhill actually changes the physics of the car, how much grip you have available, so just keep that in mind. And that's all you need to know about friction circles for now, really. And I hope you guys liked the video, learned something. This is really fundamental to everything else, racing lines, braking points, and so on, that we're going to be talking about later. Hit subscribe if you want to keep going and want to see videos like this, and I'll see you guys in the next video.